you know, once you have a kid, you just start thinking about your house. All I could think about was my home, my home. I would look at houses everywhere and I was like, how could I ever, you know, do that? I just utilized, you know, podcasts like this, Pinterest, YouTube, and I saw that people were doing it like low tech.
Welcome to the Tiny House Lifestyle Podcast, the show where you learn how to plan, build, and live the tiny lifestyle. I'm your host, Ethan Waldman, and I'm thrilled to have you join us for another adventure into the fascinating world of compact and conscious living. Today, we're venturing off the beaten path and into the realm of off-grid living with our inspiring guest, Risa, who has carved out her own piece of paradise on a multi-generational homestead. Throughout our conversation, we'll uncover the nuts and bolts of Risa's journey, from the inspirations that sparked her transition to a scaled-down, sustainable lifestyle, to the practicalities of building an affordable tiny home from an Amish-built shed shell. We'll dive into her low-tech solutions for heating, water storage, and even delve into the world of humanure composting. Get ready to be enlightened and maybe even a bit envious of the simplicity and beauty that off-grid living can offer as we explore how Risa and her son make the most out of their tiny house and the land they call home. I am here with Risa. Risa is a single mom living with her son in an off-grid tiny house on her family's multi-generational homestead. They share land with her parents and 23 animals. Risa is passionate about empowering other women to create their dream home and live a sustainable lifestyle that they can afford. Risa, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ethan. I'm so happy to be here.
Yeah, so glad to have you. So tell us the story of kind of how you came to live in an off-grid tiny house.
Yeah, well, it's always been a dream of mine. My dad built an off-grid, not tiny house. It was a pretty decent sized house, but it was a straw bale structure. And he just had these amazing off-grid systems in place. He had a greenhouse attached to it. And I was a toddler when he was doing this. So I got to be part of that experience. And it just really stuck with me. So I always had a dream to put a house of some sort. I originally wanted an off-grid straw bale house on my mom and my stepdad's property. And that kind of fell by the wayside when I met my son's father, and I kind of gave up on that idea. But we since have separated, and my son and I came back to my parents, back to the farm, and basically my grandfather, my father's father, who I'm named after, Reese. He left me a very small inheritance, and he left a little bit to my mom too. So we combined it, and I purchased an Amish built, I think it's technically a shed, but it's really more of a cabin.
Okay.
And it's a shell. So, and then I've just been busting my butt to figure out a way with very little money and help to kind of create my dream home. And so I'm pretty much more than halfway through the process right now.
Nice. Nice. So where are you in that process right now in terms of like finishing out the cabin?
Yeah. Well, as you can see, I'm downstairs right now. There isn't upstairs. It's a pony wall. So the walls are about like maybe like 2 feet, if that. And then they have like a A-frame. So the upstairs, there's no finished work done up there. Down here, I've finished all the walls. There's a few little cosmetic things like molding around the door. I have to do the floors. That's going to be last because it's just not a necessity. Okay. I have really cute rugs. And it's a very low tech. So that's another thing that I'm really passionate about is showing people that you can do off-grid without buying the expensive solar system, the nature head composting toilet, the mini split. You know, I don't have any of those things. So this is an ever evolving process. So I might upgrade as we go, but right now it's very minimal.
Okay.
I got my wood stove, you know, so pretty much finishing the upstairs and then just, you know, expanding the property. I built a patio out of the rocks that were already here. I plan to do more stuff like that.
Nice.
You know, build like a jungle gym for my son. There's always more stuff, but pretty much I have to finish the upstairs and insulate the ceiling. And that's a big one.
Okay. Yes. So when you got the shell, was there any insulation in it at all?
The only thing that there was the roof. I requested that they put in the double bubble or whatever you call that. it's that like bubble tinfoil type stuff. It does provide enough insulation for me to stay here. But when it's really cold, it's just pretty rough.
Yeah.
But that's it. The floor is insulated as well. I did make sure that they did that.
Okay. Nice. And what's your like general climate zone?
It gets cold.
Okay.
I mean, we're in the Northeast, so it can get below zero. Mm-hmm. We have big winters. Okay. It's been a lot more mild the past couple of years, but it still gets pretty cold.
Yeah. Yeah. And so you already mentioned this, but is your heating 100% wood?
Yes, 100% wood. I have a huge wood stove. It was gifted to me from my friend. It's like an old jerry-rigged thing, but it works really well. And I also cook on it in the winter.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. And so how long are you able to like leave the house for in the winter and know that it's going to stay warmish?
Warmish. Well, okay. If it's really cold, if it's like below 30.
Yeah.
Pretty much I could leave for the day and come back in the afternoon and it's fine. If it's below 20, it'll be cold.
Okay.
But if it's on a normal, like below 30 day, if I'm gone for a day and a night and a day, it is freezing and it takes forever because the wood stove has to heat up all the wood and all the materials. And it's crazy like how much heat is really stored in the structure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. And then tell me about your plumbing, or if do you have plumbing?
Well, I love my water system. So I'll start with that. Mm-hmm. I have a kind of like, I learned this from a van life post on Pinterest.
Okay.
I went back and forth whether or not I want to do a hand pump because basically there's no actual plumbing. This is technically a dry cabin.
Okay.
So what I chose was I have these 2 5-gallon food grade storage containers and I fill up the water at my parents' house.
Okay.
So that's something I do want to just disclaimer. I understand that not everybody has the opportunity to, you know, have land already at the ready for them or have the main house with all the perks. So I just wanted to state that, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I fill that up at my parents. They have a well. Mm-hmm. And then I only go through mine because I don't take showers here yet. I only go through 5 gallons of water a day.
Okay.
If I'm cooking and everything. So I only actually have to fill up one of those per day.
Yep.
And then I have a foot pump and it basically siphons the water out of a faucet that I made out of like a copper pipe with some shark bite fittings. Mm-hmm. Super inexpensive, cool way.
Yep.
And then it drains into a 5-gallon bucket. So then I can use that gray water if I want to water my gardens. I do use almost 100% natural products. I'm really big on that. So I could use it on the gardens or I do have a, you know, you can pretty much use it wherever. So that is how I do that.
Nice.
I try to collect dishwater in a bowl so that I'm not constantly having to dump it because I would have to dump it every day if I didn't do that.
Right.
And then I have a compost toilet. So a homemade one.
Okay. Mm-hmm. The humanure bucket?
Yeah, almost. So I love the humanure handbook. I love that whole system. I will say I do have a urine diverter just because I wanted it to be more just, I didn't want to deal with the girls pee a lot. Let's just say that. And we can't go pee outside. So I have a separate container for the pee. And then, yes, I do with the sawdust. I use cedar chips from Tractor Supply. I find those to work really well.
Okay. Cedar chips. Okay.
Yes. And it smells nice. You know, it has like a very, you know what cedar smells like, I'm sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I use that and I cover the solids. I use a compostable bags.
Okay.
Not biodegradable. That's something I like to tell people. You want to use compostable if you are going to use a liner.
Is it cedar, like cedar bedding?
Yes.
Or like actual wood chips?
No, it's cedar bedding. Yeah, they're called cedar chips, but it's really just like shavings.
Okay. 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 Sorry, I interrupted you.
I talk a lot. It's okay.
No, that's good. Well, you're being interviewed, so that's perfect.
Yeah. So I have a just a homemade compost bin that I made outside. And that is where I put all my compost. We have farm animals, so I use their manure for my gardens. I don't really need to use my food scraps. Yep. So I like to put that in there because that's part of the humanure system is it's good to add other organic material.
Yeah.
And so it's just made out of 4 pallets And then basically once it's full, you know, you need to have another pallet structure, but it really takes, I mean, like a good 2 years for the humanure to become safe to disperse anywhere. Mm-hmm. So right now I just have one, but it's super easy. And then that is next to our Kaibo, which I don't know. Have you ever heard of a Kaibo?
No. What's a Kaibo?
So Kaibo is a cool structure. It's like an outhouse, but it stands up on top of the ground. So it's high up. So basically everything falls into like a pile on the ground under it. And then you add the organic material. Okay. And then at once it's full, that's when you shovel it out, put it in the compost bin, let it continue to compost. Because basically that way it actually can compost because it has the airflow, it has access to water. Whereas with a, and I'm not saying that outhouses are bad. I just know that when you bury the hole, it doesn't get the airflow that it needs to properly become fertilizer.
You get the anaerobic bacteria.
Exactly.
That's super interesting. I'd love, I don't know if you're able to send me a picture of the Kaibo. I'd love to include it on the show notes
because
people would be really interested to see it.
Yeah, I have a whole blog post that I basically did on all of my off-grid systems, and that's in there. We threw it up. My stepdad and I threw it up because my dad was going to be visiting and staying in the tiny house, and my tiny little bathroom is really, it's just like a plywood wall, and at the time, I didn't even have a door, and I was like, we need a private structure. So we threw it up. We made it out of saplings.
Okay.
And corrugated steel. And I mean, it's very DIY on the cheap, but it's so cute. So yes, I would.
Nice.
That's where all the pictures of everything are. And I would love to also send them.
Okay. Awesome. I will definitely link to that blog post and I'll pull some photos so people can check them out.
Yeah.
That's super interesting. There's actually, I've been helping some friends design something like that. So I'm interested to see it because you know, the pit outhouse, as you said, creates a lot of anaerobic bacteria because there's no airflow and they smell terrible.
Yeah.
Actually, all the Vermont state parks, and I live in Vermont, they call it a moldering toilet.
Uh-huh.
And it sounds like what you described, where the toilet platform is above the ground.
Yes.
And the waste goes down into like this cage.
Yes.
It's a slower composting. Mm. So like the temperatures don't get as hot as probably in your humanure pile, but it does compost. It just takes longer.
Yeah. And so funny you say that. We got the idea. My mom got the idea at a farm called Farm and Wilderness in Vermont. So that's what they use on their campgrounds. And they call them Kaibos. And some of them have two seats. My parents have one down at their house. That one has two seats. It's very charming.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. It sounds like you've got a really great off-grid system going.
Yeah, I love it.
And it sounds like it's not just something that you're doing out of necessity. It sounds like it's what you really value.
Absolutely. I so do. Once you have a kid, you just start thinking about your house. And once I was pregnant, all I could think about was my home. I would look at houses everywhere and I was like, how could I ever, you know, do that? Like I don't have a solid job right now. I didn't at the time. I had a little, you know, baby who's attached to me 24/7. And I didn't know what I was doing, but I knew I wanted it. So I just utilized, you know, podcasts like this, Pinterest, YouTube. Mm-hmm. And I saw that people were doing it like low tech and still having a beautiful home. And I was like, okay, maybe I can do this. And it is such a passion of mine. It's one of my favorite subjects. I love showing people how they can do this too.
Yeah. So would you mind sharing like what you've spent so far?
Oh gosh. Okay. I will try. So the shell itself, it was a total of, I want to say like 16 grand delivered. Mm-hmm. And it had, I added some windows when I got it, but it had two. It came with 3, 4, 5 windows, 2 9-light doors. So it's really glary right here, but like 2 doors with windows. It was stained.
Nice.
Floor was insulated. Ceiling was insulated with the, you know, the double bubble.
Yep.
And then they delivered it. So that was, you know, I knew I wasn't able to build something like in any amount of time. Yep. So that was that. We had to pay for Crusher Run because that's what it went on top. Crusher Run is just like gravel.
Yep.
And we did do a pretty like high gravel pad. It's about like over a foot, just because, you know, we get a lot of snow here and we wanted it to be up off the ground. You don't need to do that. You can do like 4 inches worth. So we probably spent like $1,500 on the gravel. And then, so that's so like $16,000 plus $1,500. And then insulation, you know, I was using 30 bat insulation, which is pricey. It's like $90 a bag.
Mm-hmm.
So this is probably maybe like 3 or 4 bags worth. So I don't know. I don't know if you're adding this up in your head. I'm trying to think. Maybe like $20,000 total right now.
About $20,000.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, wow. I will say that everything in here has been thrifted, dug out of my parents' basement. I was buying drywall on Facebook Marketplace for like $5 because people would cut stuff out of it. And like, I was like, I don't know. I don't have money right now, but I have like ingenuity. So I'm just going to make something out of nothing. So a lot of this was, you know, gifted, hand-me-down, thrifted, dumpster dove. My tiles were, my mom found them in the dumpster. So
nice.
I utilized the Habitat for Humanity restores. I don't know if you've ever heard of those.
Yep.
They're just like places you can go for used appliances and furniture,
building materials.
So yeah, I think just if I were to guess, about $20,000.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I'm very happy with my place.
How long have you been in the house?
So I would say I got it about 2 Novembers ago.
Okay.
And I didn't start, it wasn't like livable until June, I want to say.
Okay.
I finally was at a point where I was like, okay, I think that I can set my stuff up now in a way that it doesn't have to be a complete construction zone. I can just like isolate little projects and stuff. So that's when I did that. I was sleeping upstairs when it was a complete construction zone down here.
Wow.
But I was determined to be in here in the winter. I'm still at my parents' part-time.
Mm-hmm.
But this place, I could be in here full-time right now. I will say I let my wood stove go out at night because the windows upstairs aren't really big enough for me to escape from with my little one if we had a fire. So I let it go out at night and I just have like a billion blankets and it gets cold in the morning when it's really cold outside.
I'll bet.
But I will say this is really cool. It took me forever to figure it out. This wood stove, it could be like 15 degrees outside. And if I light a fire, I can have hot water for coffee in 20 minutes. So that's pretty cool.
Nice. Nice. And so do you do all your cooking on the wood stove or do you have another way to cook?
So I have been just doing everything on the wood stove. I have a propane two burner cooktop, but the one I had originally bought and I cut out the hole in my counter for, I just realized it was really cheap. And I was like, you know, I'm not going to use this. I don't want to risk it. So I bought a more expensive one and it is off by 1 or 2 inches. So I can't use it until I cut into my tiled countertop, which so I'm just waiting on that. And it's getting to be a little too warm for the wood stove. So to be on all the time. Yeah. So, so I do have that and that would be propane just with a little 25 gallon propane container outside of the house.
Just a little tank.
Yeah.
And so I see some electric lights behind you. What is your electrical setup?
These are Lucy lights. Have you ever heard of those?
No.
Okay.
You're sharing so many great like products and terms and things. Lucy lights. Okay.
Lucy lights. It's all in my blog post.
Okay. Okay.
So the Lucy lights are awesome. We found out about them a while ago. And these particular ones they're like $54 on Amazon a piece. And the lights that you see above are connected to a little port. And that port has a solar panel on it. So you can charge it in the sun, or you could charge it in a wall or your car. It takes like an hour tops to charge.
Okay.
They say that it's 40 hours of charge time.
Okay.
I still don't know for sure if that's 100% accurate.
Okay.
But they do stay charged for a while. They have 3 light settings and I love the light that they cast. It's so close to like incandescent lighting and that's so hard to find. I really don't like the fluorescent lighting. So I love those.
Yeah.
And also what I do is I just have this guy, which also has a solar panel on it.
Okay.
And it's just like $100 charger block. And I just charge them with it like periodically throughout the day, like if they need it. So I never really have to take them out in the sun. I'm kind of in a wooded area, so I don't get a whole lot of sun here. And then I also have a little $30 on Amazon, like pendant light. If you can actually see that right there.
Okay.
It's very cute. And it has a little solar panel.
It's beautiful.
And I just put it on the outside of the house. It has a teeny tiny solar panel. And it actually also has like a, it's a little more of a garish light, but it is still warm. And it's not as bad as some of them. So, yeah.
Nice.
And I have three of the Lucy lights, two for down here, one for upstairs.
Nice. Nice. And so you charge them. They have to get charged separately. You can't charge them all together. Or can you?
I totally could. I just don't like to have to take down the charger ports. I like to just leave it all there. It's just, I get worried. Mm. I've already kind of, you know, dropped them and I don't want to break them.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, technically they're for camping and stuff, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
So you mentioned earlier kind of some of the things that are on your, like your master plan for the tiny house. Sounds like finishing out the upstairs, putting some insulation. What's on your wish list in terms of systems? Do you plan to do any upgrades or changes to any of your off-grid systems?
I do. My dad just bought me for my birthday a Jackery power station, and it's a 500 watt, and it does come with a solar panel. So that's like my upgrade from my little charger block that I'm still going to use. Power is just like, once you realize like how precious of a resource something is, it's like I'll use all the little power holders that I can. So that's going to be my like next step up. I hope to eventually have like a full solar system. I would love that. Oh, another upgrade I have coming is my friend gave me a 275 or maybe it's 250 gallon water tank, and it's attached to a utility trailer and a hose.
Okay.
And so I am going to be using that in the summer. And that way I can water my gardens if I need to. I can, it's easier to water the animals and I'll just won't have to go down as much. And I'm really excited for that. We can just hook it up to the ATV and drive it down. I have my own road access.
Okay.
So I'm like in a kind of different place than the main house. So,
okay.
And then I don't plan to do it. I grew up with wood heat. I don't plan to get like a mini split or a heater or propane. I just don't feel the need to.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay with getting a little cold sometimes and, you know,
right.
I just love wood heat.
Or a little hot.
I do. Yeah. I'm a little hot right now, to be honest.
Well, that's good for the winter, although it's a pretty mild winter.
Yeah, definitely.
So how has it been, you know, raising a child in this little cabin?
Oh, it's been so great. He loves it. And it's just so fun because we're just always, you know, together, and he has his little play area, and we're right up with, we have horses on our property. So we're right up by the horses too. And so we can just go walk outside, go see the horses. We have a teepee up here. Mm-hmm. It's just, it's so lovely. You know, my mom raised me similar to the way I'm raising my son. And, you know, this place is totally kid-sized. It's not too small for him. And it's not too small to have the two of us here.
Yeah.
I just think it's really enriching and, you know, it's going to teach him a lot about the way that you can live and being comfortable living close to the earth.
Yeah. Self-sufficiency.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you have, you know, your website is great. You know, I will definitely link to your blog post about your off-grid systems. It sounds like you really enjoy sharing about this lifestyle and helping others. Have you helped anyone else do something similar?
Not fully. I have a friend who hopes she has a dream, a van life dream, but really she wants an RV. So I plan to be helping her with a lot of this stuff. Just little things. You know, we have woofers come stay on our property. I don't know if you've heard of Woof USA.
Yeah.
So we have like more kind of situations like this throughout the property. So sometimes I have like, oh, hey mom, like for the composting toilet, we should do a urine diverter. So now she's going to do a urine diverter, but nothing large scale, but I really hope to.
Nice. Nice. Well, you definitely kind of set yourself, you know, you've got a beautiful platform for, you know, sharing all that.
Thank you.
And then in terms of the farm and the animals, are the animals like, do you get any food from the animals, or are they just for fun? Are they for work, or what do they do?
Well, so the horses actually, so aside from my blog, my mom and I have a ministry called mm-hmm. Hearts in Hand Horsemanship, where we pair okay. people with our horses as a means to heal from trauma, anxiety, just PTSD. So we serve the police, military, youth. So that's what we do with the horses. We practice natural horsemanship and we love to teach people about that.
Nice.
And so that's what our horses, and we love our horses. They're our family members. All of our animals are our family members, but we don't have any issues with slaughtering a goat to eat. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we will still name them. It's okay. We're okay with that. You know, love them, name them. And yeah. if you got to eat them, eat them. It's okay. It's so... So the goats will get meat from, I'm in the middle of writing a blog post about the birth of some new baby goats we got a couple days ago.
Nice.
So we will have milk. We'll probably start milking. And then the boys, we will probably eat when they're old enough. And the girls will probably keep for milk goats. Oh, we also have honeybees and we get honey from them. Lots of honey, but we don't sell any of it.
Nice.
Yeah. And we have lots of gardens. We have lots of raised bed gardens and we eat out of our garden all summer and fall.
Nice. What's something that surprised you about this lifestyle that you weren't expecting?
That it doesn't have to be super rustic. Mm-hmm. Like my home is, you know, it is definitely a little rustic, but it's also very much like the, you know, pictures you see on Pinterest of just a regular house. And you might not know right away that it was off-grid, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And I mean, really like low-tech off-grid. So you can have, like, you don't have to have the, you know, rustic hunting cabin in the woods aesthetic to do the low-tech off-grid. You can have the beautiful, you know, Scandi-style house that you've always dreamed of without, you know, yeah. having to have all the super fancy stuff.
Totally.
Yeah.
And then one thing that I like to ask all my guests is, you know, are there any resources like they could be YouTube channels, books, people that, you know, helped you on this journey that you'd like to share with our listeners?
Oh, absolutely. So one of my biggest inspirations is a really dear friend of mine. Her name is Ariana, mm-hmm. and she has a farm stay in Vermont called the Wild Farm Vermont. Mm-hmm. She does Airbnb. And she has like a teepee and a beautiful cabin. She has horses, mm-hmm. you know, also honestly, all sorts of animals. She eats some of them. She milks some of them. And it's just a really cool place. And she has just really inspired me and just like my design aesthetic and just making everything in your house beautiful. And she's also a single mm-hmm. mama. And she just really, I mean, she plows her own driveway with her little tractor and she is just so, mm-hmm. she's incredible. She just does everything and it's just an inspiration, but she's also like a homemaker too, like me. So she just really inspired me to do the thing and be excited about it and be excited about being a single mom homesteading in her own home. So she definitely, and then this podcast for sure. I love this podcast.
Oh, thank you.
And I also just love using Pinterest. Pretty much search off-grid cabin on Pinterest, search tiny house, you know, search whatever, how to whatever. And that's how I really found pretty much how to do everything. Honestly, more than YouTube. And I love YouTube, but YouTube I use more for inspiration. And Pinterest, I mean, really, if you want to figure out how to do stuff, there's so many people out there who are happy to show you.
That's so interesting. I feel like that's the opposite of what many people would say, that they use Pinterest for inspiration and then YouTube to learn how to do it.
Yeah, I guess, you know, I think it could be both ways.
Yeah.
I think with the YouTube, you don't see as much of the low tech as you do on sure. Pinterest or just like ways to do it. I guess I haven't seen a lot of low tech, but super like cute, like, no offense, I love the off-grid cabin in the woods with like the hunting aesthetic.
Yeah.
But like you don't see a lot of like a mix. It's usually the really nice, pretty ones are really expensive, you know? And I see that a lot more on YouTube.
Yeah.
But I did watch a lot of the like, you know, bushcraft guys making their cabins in the woods on YouTube. And I love that.
Nice. Nice. Well, Risa, thank you so much for being a guest on the show today. I really, really enjoyed meeting with you and loved our conversation.
Me too. This has been such a joy. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much to Risa for being a guest on the show. Risa shared so many great resources like the Lucy Lights, Woofing, the Wild Farm in Vermont, and her blog post on off-grid systems. And I've shared all those links as well as some photos of Risa's home over at thetinyhouse.net/290. Again, that's thetinyhouse.net/290. Well, that's all for this week. I'm your host, Ethan Waldman, and I'll be back next week with another episode of the Tiny House Lifestyle Podcast.